listening to The Sports Fix. /The Sports Fix.
Hey guys, J-Rocc here from The Sports Fix, and we always talk about using world everywhere I is one of the problems in today's society. There's nothing worse than any person, big or small, strong or weak, adult or child, feeling picked on, pushed around, vulnerable, and victimized at the hands of a bully. Change comes one person at a time, and my good friends at No Such Thing as a Bully are working on skills and techniques and ways that we can all change and make things better for everyone. Find out more at NoSuchThingAsABully.com.
Portions of The Sports Fix brought to you by Fantasy Jocks. The Fantasy Fix.
Go off and running this end of the week edition of the Sports Fix. What a week it's been here for sure. The end, and we're gonna wrap it up to get into it. The sports writer extraordinaire Jonathan Knight back in the house today after a week off last week. Jeff Gorman's spectrum of things. We're talking Cavaliers. They and David Griffin. Hey man, it is the 20th anniversary, and they're all in town this weekend. The 1995 Cleveland Indians, the team that went to the World Series, that captured the hearts of Cleveland and just started that whole run there. That was the real breaking of the ice there. Of course, 94 kicked it off. 95, the pump was primed and off and running. And along the way, the Indians scalped themselves quite a few teams. And yeah, see what I did there? They had a hell of a season. I know that's not politically correct to do nowadays, but we're going to talk about all of that. Browns final big mini camp before they take their break and then head in for training camp. Jeff Gorman, Browns101.com, he's going to be here. We'll talk to Jeff about that stuff. Manziel, all the things that come out of there, the defense, they're getting ready, man. We're going to talk about all of these things and more. Let's do the thing. Welcome in, you guys, to the Sports Fix. J-Rocc here, the big daddy on the microphone. Happy to be here and in another week with you live across the Sports Fix radio network. Maybe you're joining us live on TuneIn, Breaker, and right to our home base, thesportsfix.net. Our one-stop shop, everything you need for our show, live, on demand, social media, it's all tied in right there. Bookmark it if you haven't, thesportsfix.net as well. Welcome into the thousands and thousands of you guys around the world who listen all different times of day or night, 24 hours a day, on sites on digital delays such as iHeartRadio, the world's largest internet radio network, on iTunes, on Stitcher Radio, on all of the places that you guys get the show, get the feed, get your fix. Thank you so much for doing it. Phones are going to be limited today because, as I said, JK, he's just about 10 minutes away joining us to kick things off. Jeff Gorman, following right up with him, but you can always leave your take on the take line, 216-539-7535, 216-539-7535. Facebook, Twitter, social media, always a way to get through anytime during the show or day or night. Facebook.com/TheSportsFix. Tweet with us at The Sports Fix, CLE. Email us, baby. TheSportsFix@AOL.com. Damn right, I'm feeling good today. I hope you are too. It's been, like I said, an up and down week. And here, kind of one door closes, another one opens, as I say, with the Indians and the weekend. They're getting ready to kick off here. You know, I'm curious. Well, I'll get into it in a minute because I've got an interesting question for Jonathan Knight here when he comes on, because all the love, and it's never going to go away, and I'm one of those guys that was inoculated right into that whole 94-95 swell of emotion for the Indians there that got started. But I find it interesting because, you know, yeah, the Cavaliers had a mini run there in the 80s where they were a good team again for a while. But, I mean, I find it funny when I look back and how remembered the Indians of 95 are, which they should be. I'm in no way shining any kind of shade on that. What I'm saying is I think about how fondly remembered they are to this day. I mean, literally, the Indians build their marketing campaigns around how many 95 Indians references can we squeeze into a season? And I'm all about that. But it makes me wonder. It doesn't make me wonder. It's just funny. The 2007 Cavs, you know, that went to the finals against the Spurs, I think of how, and I'm talking about in hindsight, not when it was happening. Of course, Cleveland was going crazy in 2007 when the Cavs went to the finals and got swept. But I just think of how it's remembered now. And, of course, this year will be different in how it's remembered for all the different circumstances. And I know being swept, maybe, but still the first time in franchise history. I mean, the Indians had been to a World Series. It had been a long, long time, but they had been there before, you know. But, I mean, they and it was a long drought in a new park. And I know that they're not the exact same. And I'll get into this, like I said, with JK in a little bit. But that was the first one. Doesn't matter if you got swept, if you lost in seven, whatever. That was the first one. The first run all the way to the finals in franchise history. And today, when you bring up that 2007 Cavs team, the look on people's faces, it's not the same as when you bring up the 1995 Indians. That's all I'm saying. And I find that amazing because that's the first one. Anyways, we'll get into that in a minute. But I want to talk real quick about this year's Cavs and what went down yesterday. David Blatt, David Griffin, they do the presser. I don't know how many of you guys know this. And I just happened to have somebody captured the clip and sent it to me off their DVR. Bruce Drennan, local sports talk guy on Sports Time Ohio. He usually hosts from the Indians ballpark there during the season and stuff. Long time local guy here. Radio, TV, all of that stuff. And he was on the air right in the, like, 2 minutes before David Blatt and David Griffin's press conference was getting ready to kick off for the end of the season media availability. And Bruce Drennan comes across, gets this look on his face. He's reading something, and then he goes, I've got to let you guys know that my very good trusted source, who's Givaliers, has just informed me that in 2 minutes, David Blatt is going to resign as the head coach of the Cleveland Cavaliers. Bombshell dropped. And, of course, as you know, nothing of the sort happened. And what David Blatt and David Griffin did was went out there and just poo-pooed all these ridiculous stories that are floating out here that the Cavs are in any way thinking of making. They're not making a single change. And if that is not completely crystal clear now, of course it won't be. And David Griffin made a great point. I'm not going to hammer on Bruce Drennan because we've all had our Mark Trumbo moment before, as you guys know, listening to the show. But still, not a good thing at all, because he was pretty demonstrative that it was going down and then had to eat it just a few minutes later. But just seriously, I see you over there. I'm not trying to get too heavy on Bruce there at all with that, but that is something that I point to all the time. You guys, you know, everybody goes through it. Everybody has a moment like that, but it's the overall track record. And that's why I try to be so careful in delineating when I say, hey, this is something that somebody said might happen. Very, very rarely do you draw the line in the sand because of things like that. But going back to what David Griffin said, he not only defused what people have said, but he hit the exact point that I mean, I'm not the only one that said this. I'm not trying to just give myself credit, but he talked about how it's the cool narrative that never has to go away, that David Blatt's job is in jeopardy. And those were his exact words, was David Griffin, the Cavs general manager. He said, literally, it never has to go away. No matter how many times we win, no matter how much we win, no matter who defuses it. He said, if I remember right, LeBron's exact words was David Blatt's done a hell of a job and he did nothing but say good things. So if we're just going to go by what people are saying, and that's all you can do, this is all noise. And he mentioned how David Blatt did a better job than anybody in the Cavaliers, including himself, of blocking out the noise, the garbage that comes from the media. Not media that are being truthful and respectful and looking for what's going on, but the ones that create their own news, particularly Brian Windhorst, those guys that we talk about, that's unacceptable stuff. And it's never going to go away. David Griffin hit it on the head. It doesn't matter if they win the title. It still would have been, it was only because of LeBron and they won it in spite of David Blatt, and his still would have been supposedly on his way out the door. But I loved the stuff that they talked about yesterday, and anything that they said is exactly a parrot of what I'm going to tell you right here. We've gone over it ad nauseum, and I'm sure in a few minutes when JK joins us, we're going to go over it again. But I was really glad to hear them put to rest that. The one thing I was curious about, as Mike Brandenberry and I were getting into yesterday, was is there a truth to the fact that David Blatt perhaps was thinking about, and I thought, you know, I didn't think it had anything to do with basketball. I didn't think he wanted to leave because he was, you know, didn't like the situation. The only thing I wondered was there perhaps a family reason? Because it is tough to leave your family thousands and thousands of miles away overseas. I mean, you're not even just where you can get on a plane and go a few states away and visit them like many of the players that go play in a different city, but you're literally in another continent there from the rest of your family. That's a tough thing. I wasn't sure if that maybe would be an issue with David Blatt, but I was glad to hear. I mean, he is all in, as the Cavaliers appear to be on him, and they've got a lot of work to do. And you hear this morning, word starting to come out, Cavs already on that actively. A lot of people forgetting, and I have to remind myself too, when you look at how they're going to kind of be hamstrung with free agency, as far as depending on how much cap room they have to go after other teams' free agents. They're going to be able to nail their own free agents. No, you can exceed the salary cap for that. It's going after other guys that's going to be the issue of whether you have millions to offer, whether you have to go with the mid-level exception, with the whatever, all the different salary cap permutations that there is for them. But the Haywood contract, you know, Brendan Haywood, that expiring contract that's sitting out there, I think up until August or end of July, if teams trade for Brendan Haywood, they can cut him, and he's nearly $11 million that gets dropped off of somebody's salary that can make a huge swing for a team that's in salary cap trouble or luxury tax trouble. And the Cavs actively working to move that and perhaps package their first-round draft pick with it, or maybe make a trade for some other assets. But that's a big piece there that the Cavs have the ability to use besides what they're going to do here in free agency. We're going to talk about all of this. I kind of set the stage. I want to dive right into this stuff with the Indians. Now, then, 95, the Cavs run. It comes to an end. Let's get into all of this with my man, Jonathan Knight, the sports writer extraordinaire, and we'll get rocking and rolling. Jeff Gorman still to join us and so much more. Don't go anywhere. That's right. Coolio, that fantastic voyage. We're going to do it with Jonathan Knight riding up and down. Ride, slide, slippity slide. That's right. Coming on back, doing the sports fix with JK, the sports writer extraordinaire, next after this. Place where my kids can play outside without living in fear of a drive-by. And even if I get away from them drive-by suckers, I still got to worry about those switch-ass.
Get your fix.
Because it's Friday, you ain't got no job, and you ain't got shit to do.
It's the Sports Fix. We'll be right back.
Hey guys, before we go to the break, I want to talk to you a little bit again about our good friends at Harry Buffalo North Olmsted, the UFC, the Ultimate Fighting Championships, some of the hottest fights in the world today. Each and every one of their huge events, Harry Buffalo is one of the few places in Northeast Ohio you can go there and watch each and every UFC fight at the Harry Buffalo. And let me tell you, I've been there. The people are out the door. They are to the rafters. It is one of the craziest environments for some UFC fights. Wing Mondays, they've got great deals on wings and drinks. And every day of the week, there's a different special, a different deal. And don't forget the Bison Burger, the unbelievable. It is the combination of a fantastic burger and eating healthy combined into one unbelievable sandwich. You have got to get a Bison Burger while you're there. So whatever you're looking for, Wednesday, Saturday, Sundays, there's something for you at the Harry Buffalo North Olmsted, just outside Great Northern Mall. Check them out today. Harry Buffalo, join the herd.
The Sports Fix is on iHeartRadio. Download the free iHeart app today. Subscribe to the show and get your fix. Fantasy sports lovers, you put so much time, hard work, and effort into playing week to week that it quickly stops being a fantasy and starts getting real. And when the smoke clears, you want to show off those victories with a real prize.
I mean, a really real prize.
Nobody does that like Fantasy Jocks. The crew over at Fantasy Jocks have beautiful, high-quality, and heavy-duty championship belts, ring all your fantasy sports needs. There's literally only one place to go. FantasyJocks.com.
We're going to bring it on in. It's time now. It's all city. We got to do it for them, dog. We got to do it for Cleveland. They're waiting on us.
Every single night, every single practice, every single game, we got to give it all we got because they're going to ride with us. Everything that we do on this floor, because of this city, we owe them. We're going to grind for this city. They're going to support us, man, but we got to give it all back to them. We get it done. The toughness that we have on the court is going to come from this city. Everybody, the whole city of Cleveland. That's what it's all about. It's time to bring them something special. Let's go. Bring it on in, everybody. Let's go. Hard work on three. Together on six. One, two, three.
Hard work.
Four, five, six.
Together.
One, two, three.
Hard work.
Four, five, six.
Together.
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 Together. Together. It's all us. Cleveland on three. One, two, three.
Hey everybody, this is Jerry the King Lawler from WWE, and you're listening to The Sports Fix.
Oh my God, it's him. Crank it, Jerry!
Welcome back to The Sports Fix Live. J-Rocc back with you here, rolling on, getting ready to be joined by the sports writer extraordinaire, Jonathan Knight. A whole lot to get into. I kind of set the stage where I want to go, and I wanted to, man, so many different ways, and hopefully we're able to keep this going. I just get a disturbing text message from JK. I don't know how long this conversation's going to go, but let's get into it, guys. You keep it rolling with us. Facebook and Twitter, facebook.com/thesportsfix. Tweet with us at The Sports Fix CLE. I'm going to go to the phones. My man Jonathan Knight writes for, well, the Cleveland Fan, for Everybody Hates Cleveland. He's the author of The Inside Look at the Making of Major League and so much more. My man Jonathan Knight. I call him the sports writer extraordinaire. JK, how you doing, my man?
Jerry, I'm doing well. Yeah, hopefully this will last. As I told you, I didn't know my battery and my cell phone's about to die, so if I suddenly disappear, I apologize. Just won't use any big words. We'll be okay.
All right, there we go. Yeah, I looked down at my phone, and I'm like, oh, man, okay, well, I don't know how long this is going to last, but here we go. Man, I don't know where to start. I guess let's kind of pick up, obviously, since the last time we talked, and during the commercial break, I had to write myself a note because I go, oh, I guess I should have pulled the all-in commercial out of circulation because the season is now over, but
yeah.
You know what? I'm not, because it still makes me feel good to listen to it. And talk to me a little bit, my man. I was mentioning yesterday, right before you called, the press conference. I was so happy. I mean, so many people with their false stories, and David Griffin nailed it. He said, look, it doesn't matter. I think it's great that you guys can literally just say David Blatt's job is always in jeopardy. Doesn't matter if we win. Doesn't matter what we do. I think it's really cool that you get to do that, but it's so far from reality that it's not even funny. But that was one of the biggest things I got coming out of it. But talk to me about the end of the season. I mean, these Cavs couldn't have given any more than they did.
Yeah, and I think we're getting a little bit of distance, and it's been a couple of days, and I think over the course of the summer it'll sink in a little bit more that a year ago this was not in the realm of possibility, and we're beginning to remember that. And even in January, this was not in the realm of possibility, and we're beginning to remember that. So these little things are starting to sink in, and we're starting to realize, wow, this really was special. And if you think back even to the beginning of the season when expectations were pretty high, I think the realistic expectation in mine was, I remember predicting they would make it to the finals and lose. Not quite the way that they did it, but that was what I had in mind. And that's exactly what I had set out for them to do, and thinking that, well, next year they'll be better. And so the stage is set, and as hard as it was to kind of watch them limp off stage there, you're right. They gave it more than we could have really expected from them, and there are certainly high hopes and high expectations for next season.
I went back and checked just to make sure, and I was exactly the same as you. My best prediction up until the final months of the season, when that team went 33-3 down the stretch and turned into a monster, when you said, wait a minute, now they could win the whole thing here. But up until the team was changed with the trades and stuff, I was with you. I said they'll make it to the finals and they'll lose to whatever team comes out of the West. I was thinking it was going to be the Spurs, to be honest. But that was kind of where I was at. And a lot of people didn't even go that far. And I was saying that yesterday and Monday even. I'm like, guys, think back to what your best predictions were, unless you're crazy and you just said they were winning the title the first day LeBron came, which I know some people did that. But everybody realistically at the beginning of the season, I've gone back and listened to the show. People were like, man, they'll lose to Chicago in the finals of the East. Or, you know, maybe they'll get out of the East. Nobody had them winning the whole thing. And obviously that changed and then changed again. And that literally took a team. And I've been playing this game. I dare you to take any team in the NBA and just take the exact course and then the first game of the finals and tell me which team still get to the finals and then tell me which team loses their number one B player in the first game of the finals and then still nearly wins the damn thing. I mean, they're a bad overtime away from starting that series up 3-0 the way the series played out. And that is amazing when you look at how it happened.
Yeah, and that's it. That's again, if nothing else, I think it gives us a lot of optimism. And that's what we're going to be left with once this disappointment starts to fade. We're going to be left with, gosh, wow, what if they had gone into this series with, never mind being completely healthy, let's say one of those three starters from opening night that was hurt. What if one of them played? God, what if two of them played? God forbid, what if three of them were able to play? So. Lots of anticipation for what the Cavs, and there's a lot of questions. There's a lot of things that are going to happen here in the next few months. But absolutely, there is a sense that boy, the Cavs they did well in this year's playoffs. They did well the last 2 months of the regular season. But boy, they could be even better next year.
They will be. See, that's somewhere that I differ with a lot of people where you just said, what about all the questions? I don't see things that are bad for these players. Reasons that he's leaving, whether it's Tristan, whether it's for season, with them being able to move. Now, they won't be able to do this next summer, but with them being able to move that Haywood contract, they may actually really be able to improve more than people think this summer. But Mike Brandenberry made a hell of a point yesterday, and I used to fight the opposite. The first LeBron run, people would say, oh, who doesn't want to play with LeBron James and blah, blah, blah. And I would say a lot of people because they didn't come here. And you can say, well, it's because it's Cleveland. I say, if you want to do it, you'll play with him in Siberia. But after this run, I was joking that when LeBron turned his cell phone back on after the playoff run, there were more than a handful of, hey, man, if you need some help, hit me up, man, and I'll come to Cleveland. Because who, after seeing and saying, they're all saying what we're saying. Boy, imagine if Cleveland had one more thing, had one more piece. They would have swept this whole thing, you know? How many people don't want to come be a part of that? And I'm just saying, that's different than LeBron 1.0. I think there will be no shortage of players willing to play for the veteran minimum, willing to play for a reduced role to come in here and be a part of what they just watched in the playoffs. I mean, that was, by the end, it was one man dragging the truck through, and it was something not many people have seen. And I think that there is no shortage of players that are going to go, hell, I'll link myself up to that chain and come in there and help them out.
Yeah, and that's what's exciting, particularly when you look at how the Cavs were able to change the horses in midstream in this season, that whoever comes or goes, whoever they want to keep, they don't want to keep in the offseason, that they'll have plenty of options, whether free agency or trades or whatever, that there will be plenty of people willing to listen to their phone calls, which the Cavs are able to kind of make the deals that they did in the middle of the year when they were really locked in to what they could and couldn't do, mostly couldn't do, This is really liberating. So it'll be fun to see what Griffin and the front office is able to pull off here with, like you said, I think a lot more enthusiasm to play with LeBron and to play in Cleveland than there's ever been before.
Absolutely. And I think there's a significant move that they can do with that Haywood contract. I'm going to be really interested in seeing. But the fun starts. I mean, really, that's the other good thing about it running all the way till the end of June is that we're like a week or two from free agency and we just stopped playing basketball. And we get to dive right
back
into it.
Feels like we're a week or two from training camp.
You know what I'm saying?
It feels like they're about to
start. LeBron's going to take a cruise for 2 weeks and then we're right back at this thing.
And right back at it. God, yeah.
I love it. That's great to me. I love it. The longer these sports can go, the more they run together. That means you had a very good run the previous season. Speaking of runs, I posed this question, and I was waiting for you to come on to dive into it. I've never really got into this with anybody before. You know, 95 Indians are coming in to kind of tie these two subjects together. This Cavs run, to me, will go down as one of the – this one has to be up there with, like, the 95 Indians, with those ones that live with you forever. This was special what we saw. Who cares? cares that it ended, you know, just a hair short of where you wanted it to. This was an unbelievable deal. I think it's the best in Cavs history. I mean, over the miracle of Richfield, even. I know you can never have your first time again, but this was pretty freaking special. But I've got a question. Speaking of first times, 2007, right? Cavaliers' first run to the NBA Finals. Of course, they got swept, and I understand that. But it was the first in franchise history. I mean, yeah, they teased a little bit in the 80s. Other than that, a whole bunch of nothing for 40 years, practically, and they get to the finals. I'm curious how we, 20 years later, and I do it too. I love the 95 Indians. They're one of my favorite things that ever happened in Cleveland sports. Look at the difference in how that team, and now the Indians had won a World Series, even though it had been half of 100 years before, but the Indians run. Look at how it's remembered, and think of 2007, not then. Everybody was happy in 2007. When you mention the 2007 Cavs nowadays, people get this look like your dog just pooped on their lawn a little bit when you bring it up. It does not have any kind of real emotional significance to Cleveland fans. And I'm like, boy, how come that is so much different than 95 when that was also a big run? First time it was, who cares how it ended? I mean, they all end with us losing at some point, you know, but you ever notice that people do not love those 2007 Cavs?
Yeah, that's a good point. And that's a good comparison because both teams wound up making it to the same level and with the same result. They both made it to their champion, the world championship level and lost in that series. But you're right. The 95 Indians are much more embraced. My God, I don't think in 2027 we're going to be having a remember the 07 Cavs weekend. I don't think we're going to be getting that. And I think a couple of reasons. One, that it had been a really long drought for the Indians, a longer drought, since they'd even made the postseason, and that team did. And that team was dominant. I mean, that team was not only dominant, but it was exciting. It was that rare combination that they kicked butt, but they also won a whole bunch of comebacks and dramatics and what have you. So there was that. There was also that sense that they really kind of, in a way, came out of nowhere. I mean, they blasted through expectations. They were decent in 94. They were a playoff contender till the strike. But 95, nobody anticipated what they did. With the Cavs in 07, or even in that, in 06, as LeBron matured, there was an expectation this was supposed to happen. And 07, the regular season, was not impressive. Really, that season didn't become memorable until game five of the Eastern Conference Finals with Detroit. And then we remember that. We remember game six. We don't remember anything else from that playoff run. We don't remember the finals because they were a blur and a sweep. So that was just a very unsatisfying experience. It was fun for about a week, and then it was over. It came out of nowhere and emerged back into nowhere. So, I have a clearer memory, even though they didn't go as far. I have a much clearer memory of 08, 09, and 2010 than I do of 2007. But that's an interesting point. I never really thought to compare the two, but that's a really interesting dichotomy there between those two seasons.
I mean, nothing compares to the 95 Indians to me. I mean, that's my team as much as anybody else. I'm one of those guys too, man. You know, like I said, the Indians can make a whole marketing campaign out of how many times can we squeeze the 95 Indians into a season here. And it's great. I love it. And this weekend's going to be awesome. They're all in town and the fan base. This is going to be a great weekend for that, for the Indians down there. Yeah. And it's cool.
And you know
coming.
What? I think this season too, to interrupt it, I think this will, while it's better than 2007 and better than those other 3 years we talked about, I don't know that this season will really be remembered quite that fondly. Like you said, you thought it was better than Miracle Richfield. Nothing will be better than the Miracle Richfield until they win. When they win, that will be better. But up until that point, Miracle Richfield, as silly as it sounds, because on paper they didn't even make it to the final, but that because it's your first, any number of reasons why. That's a whole show we could do on the Miracle Richfield. But I think that, again, because there was that expectation, even though the season was a roller coaster and the playoffs were, you know, amazing what they were able to overcome, those are all great stories. And to me, that makes it number two. It puts it above 07, it puts it above those other years. But there was that expectation, and the expectation, whether it was realistic or not, was that, well, we got LeBron now, we're going to win. And even now, going into next year, it's like, well, next year will be better. So I guess there was a little bit of that in 95 going into 96 with the Indians, but 96, they clearly didn't go as far. 96 was a letdown, so 95 still kind of remained. And even 97, they went to the World Series, but came out of nowhere. And that was just a totally different team and a totally different season. So enabling 95 to kind of stand alone. So this year, I think for better or worse for the Cavs, I think it's going to be saddle stitch to whatever happens next year. So I hope that there's better things to come, but if this winds up being the high point of LeBron 2.0, then yeah, it'll be interesting to see where it does fall in the legacy.
And like I said, I wasn't trying to compare the two, and I know what you're saying there. It's just that was the first one, and you would think that would have a bit of a soft spot, but it didn't.
It would.
I agree with you here about this one, although to me, I don't know how. I know people will forget about it, because especially depending on what happens the next few years, but it's like 95 and 97 for the Tribe. 97 is such a better story, man. I mean,
sure.
97 was
the playoff,
run.
Playoff, certainly.
That's what I mean.
Was something to behold. The regular season was 95. The playoff was 97.
Well, the 95 Indians was the probably the only time in Cleveland history since maybe the Browns run of dominance back in the early days, like where the Indians can just – the Cleveland can have a franchise that just owned everything. They just dominated it. That's the murderer's row. That's the 27 Yankees. That's one of the best offensive teams in the history of Major League Baseball. So that's – and that's why I feel differently about 97, because 97 was the little engine that could and just kept doing, and then they made their playoff run. You know, 95 was like LeBron's Cavs. That was the team that was supposed to beat everybody up. See, I don't feel like they caught people by surprise. I think they knew how good they were, and they were taking 50 years of frustration out on baseball.
Yeah. And I think this year's Cavs are probably closer to the 97 Indians than the 95 Indians.
Right.
Because they were that little engine, at least in the playoffs. I think they were. We did get that little taste of dominance in the last couple of months of the regular season. But, I think they much more resembled the 97 Indians in this playoff run, because it was just improbable that they would even get past the second round, let alone get to the finals and do it the way they did. So, and now you've set the stage for what happens next year. Are they going to be dominant? Are they going to be this sort of one step forward, two steps forward, one step back type of season? So, the stage is set. This could go one of two ways. I think they're either going to – it won't be like this year, one way or the other. The regular season will probably be better, and then it's like, well, okay, how do you top this playoff run? What happens next?
Well, you win, that's how. But I'll be honest, my prediction, just based on the way the look, especially in the last few games of that series, the pure frustration, and not in a bad way, the kind of frustration that I saw on LeBron's face at sea in 2010 when it looked like he had already checked out. You saw a guy who said, wow, they did everything they could do to take it from us here, and I'm going to come back and take it back from them. I truly believe that this run, not just the injuries, but the officiating, all of the things that the Cavs dealt with along the way, I think it makes a group of guys that go out. This is going to be one of them seasons next year, like the 95 Indians, where the Cavaliers come out and take their frustration from the finals out on the NBA next season.
I can see that. And you know what I kept thinking? This is interesting to stretch the parallel beyond Cleveland. What I was thinking, particularly in those last two games, I kept seeing, if you remember back before Michael Jordan and the Bulls became the world champion Bulls, when they, I think it was three years
Pistons.
In a row that the Bulls, they would get through the first round or get through the second round and then run into the Pistons. And basically all they had was Jordan. Tiffin hadn't quite emerged yet, and it was just Jordan and this ragtag cast of cast-offs, essentially, that would go up against Detroit. And they would give them, basically they matched up the way that the Cavs, the injured Cavs, did with Golden State. And I saw a lot of parallels with that it was just, Jordan was able to make some of those series close. One year they went 6, one year they went 7, but just couldn't quite do it as the team started to emerge. And then finally in 1991, they had that team together. They faced Detroit again in the conference finals and swept them, and now they were over the hump. And that's what this felt like. It's different, obviously, because the Cavs were a better team than that. They just weren't able to play those guys. But watching the Cavs in those last three games, I was thinking of the 88, 89, 90 Chicago Bulls before they had it quite put together. Every time they'd face Detroit, they had Jordan and nothing else. And Jordan was enough to get them a couple wins, but not enough to win the series. And they learned from that, and Jordan came back hungrier. And finally, they did get over the hump and won 3 straight and then 3 straight again. So this is a different situation, obviously, but I see those echoes there, that this could be a similar type of resolution.
That's a great parallel because I see many of the same things, man. And this is going to be very interesting to see what pieces they do put back together. And like you said, 2 months from now, they're going to training camp and they're going back at it again. So all we've got, what, 6 weeks of baseball, then we got training camp, and then another training camp. We'll be doing all these sports all over again.
And we're still tired. You know, I mean, there's all the talk about LeBron being tired, and obviously he clearly was, and he needs a break. But, God, I'm tired. Cleveland fans are tired. I think the one silver lining to this ending Tuesday is like, well, at least we can get a good night's sleep. Like, it's been about a month since we got to go to bed before midnight on some of these nights and are sleepy-eyed and depressed or euphoric the next day. Now we can at least establish a regular sleeping pattern again.
I agree. A buddy of mine said the same thing, and I said, yeah, but you know what? It feels like the day after the NCAA title game. You just overdosed on basketball for a month or 3 weeks or however long it is, and now there's none. And you're like, oh, man. But you are right, because we were every other night living and dying with this thing, man, and I cannot wait to get to
it. And it was
again.
Fun. Yeah, don't mistake me. It was fun.
Fun. That's the thing, is fun. Next season will be expectations. Next season will be big business. All of that stuff. Seriously. Next season will be this season without the fun, sentimental stuff. Because then it, I don't want to say unfinished business. Don't put it on a t-shirt, guys. But
No t-shirt.
It's going to be out there. Hey, real quick, before I let you go, my man, we were talking about this weekend, Indians 95 Indians. I also haven't talked to you in 2 weeks since the Indians jumped the shark and brought up Francisco Lindor. And now, and Lindor, the infield of the future is the infield of today. And we've seen, although a couple of uncharacteristic errors in his first few games, but a couple of flashes. Boy, yesterday, one play with Lindor and two with Urshela where I go, boy, man, those are some Omar Vizquel-type plays over there that you can see what's coming very quickly on that side of the infield. How fired up are you?
Yeah, this is fun. You know, I mean, I was very hesitant, as were the Indians, and wisely so, to not bring him up too early. But I think they just reached a point where, like, all right, first of all, the need demands it, because you just basically jump ship with the left side of your infield. Like, well, if there's ever a time to do it, it's now. And they just kind of had to kind of throw caution to the wind a little bit, because he wasn't tearing them up at Columbus. He was good, but I think they wanted to make sure they were careful and not rush him too early, and because we played this game before. But yeah, I think that what you're seeing is, and this may, there's going to be ebbs and flows. There's going to be a series of advances and retreats here. He's started off well, and he's doing things well. But as we've seen time and time again, when you bring a hotshot prospect up and he starts out solid, that's great, and usually does forecast a nice career. But inevitably, the pitchers will adjust, and he'll slump, and it's just he needs to adjust. So it's just a series of adjustments begin. So it's going to be forward and backward. But you much prefer him coming out hot and making an impact right away and bringing energy right away. That's probably the most important thing that he's done, rather than coming and starting 1-for-40 or something like that. And you think, God, this guy's just not ready. No, he's even if he's not ready now, he was on the brink of being ready, and he's going to be a good major league player. I think we've seen that. There's enough there that sooner or later, whether it's this year, whether it's next year, whenever it is, he's going to be a bona fide big league player, and the Indians are going to be very happy that they brought him up when they did, I think. I think just the energy alone, like I said, is enough. People are excited. People want to see him. And you saw it, I think, last night a little bit. He came home and scored that run from third. I don't think that's a play that they made a week ago. I don't think anybody on the team would have made that play. And he did. And you know, you could say that was the difference in the game. So, yeah, I mean, it's exciting. The Indians needed some excitement, because this, especially with the cap now shuffling off stage, the Indians are up there. And how ironic, too, that the very first game the Indians play after we've talked for 2 months about, well, the Indians are in a bubble now. Now nobody's caring. They can do whatever they want. So the very first game they play, when they're center stage all alone, they lose 17-0.
I know.
Is that not the legacy of this team for the last 15 years? Like, I feel like every time the Indians, they work so hard to get this great job interview, and they're on the brink of great opportunity, and then they forget to wear their pants to the interview or something. Like, that's the Indians. They work so hard, and they try to get attention, and they're right. They have Cleveland right in the cusp of their hands, and then they just blow it. When everybody's looking, then they fall apart. So it's one game, whatever. But I thought that was symbolic of what the Indians have struggled with over the last decade or so. yourself.
Actually, it's funny you say that. I felt like you with this stat because you had done the article a few weeks ago about just that. But now in the 7 years that the Cavaliers and the Indians, you know, have coincided with the playoff run there, the Indians are now 1-6 in their first game after the end of whatever the Cavaliers playoff run is.
How funny is that? Yeah.
So, yeah, just goes to show that point that you made. And I think what's interesting about the dynamic is not just one, but you got both. Third base and shortstop at the same time, basically, within a few weeks. You bring, usually a team will bring one and not necessarily want to have both of the rookies going there kind of feeling their oats at the same time. But the Indians threw them both. And in like last night, you mentioned Lindor scores from third. Urshela gets the game-winning hit, and you see them flashing some leather in the field. That's going to be interesting to watch. I mean, just even watching some of those guys, watching some of the double plays they've turned in the last two or three games, I'm going, boy, this looks like some good stuff coming here. And I mean, anybody that's watched those two knew that they both made their call in with their glove, and a lot of people don't realize that yet, but they're starting to see it early on. And it is, it's excitement, and perhaps this changes the dynamic of the rest of the Indian season. At least that's what they hope. Obviously, you know, this whole series, young guys on both sides. We were talking about it yesterday. How about the kid drafted less than a year ago, Kyle Schwarber? He gets called up this year. I mean, look at the difference between that and Lindor. He's less than 10 months or whatever from getting drafted, and he's called up for a week. And he's going back down, but that kid is doing his best not to go back down. He went 6-for-10 in the 3 games that he played against the Indians with a home run, and he tied that game yesterday. But, boy, they got some good young guys over there, too, with Schwarber and with Chris Bryant.
Yeah, they do.
They got a murderer's row coming, I think, up from their minors as well.
Yeah. And that's, you know, and backing out and looking at it from a higher level, it's fun to play the Cubs. You know, I think it's been so long. It's been several years, I think 5 years,
Six years, I think, since they've
played the Cubs. They got to do both at Wrigley and then in Cleveland. So that was fun to see. And now that the Cubs are better, that's even all the more, I think. And you saw a lot of Cubs fans in the 2 games in Cleveland. I think that's fun. And between that and between Lindor and Giovanni coming up, I think that you saw that there's some exciting things happening finally for the Indians, because there really hasn't been all that much excitement in this season thus far. You know, and at least for a couple of days, it's like, okay, even though they did, you know, there's that little 17, and it was still a fun week, and leading into a nice fun weekend with the 95 team being recognized. So yeah, you're right. Maybe the Indians are going to turn it around here.
Well, I hope so, because Detroit's waiting on the other side of this fun 95 weekend. So we'll see how they fare on that. Matter of fact, I saw the Tribe switch their rotation around because they've got the mystery fifth starter. I think it's going to be Anderson, perhaps. I think I saw is going to be the guy that gets the next shot at it, perhaps Cody Anderson. But anyways, they switched it around because he was set to go against Detroit on Monday. So they flip-flopped him and Bauer to make sure that they at least don't sacrifice the young pitcher in his first opportunity there against
young
Detroit.
Young pitcher, everybody. Hide the whip, everything. He's hitting Kluber. He's hitting everybody. Don't send a rookie out there. Oh, my God.
I know. So they flip-flop, so Bauer's going to get him. But, hey, it'll be a fun weekend this weekend. Hey, speaking of fun, about a week and a half from now, I kind of already started teasing. We'll get the details set up, but I can't wait. Get you in the studio. We're going to do a little major league show.
Yeah. How fun is that going to be? I am so excited for this, Jerry. It has been over 4 years since I've been in studio. So I'm. It's like a kid looking forward to Christmas. I cannot wait to do that again. And even more than that, get to then talk about our favorite movie. So much fun. We're counting down the days.
How's the book doing, by the way? Things going well?
Yeah, it's going well. I mean, it's been, I tell you what, promoting a book is almost like more work than actually writing the book. Like, it's not necessarily harder, but it is, it's like doing everything left-handed. Like, for writers write, and then it's like, okay, now you got to go out and talk about what you wrote about, and it becomes a different story. So, yeah, there's been a lot of interviews, a lot of what have you. Reviews are coming out now, and the reviews are really good, which is great. You know, you always kind of hold your breath on that. But everything's been going really well. I mean, it's gotten a really good reception. Everybody seems excited about it. So interested to, you know, to get on the show and talk to more people who have read it and kind of get the feel of the people on this thing. But it's so far so good. It seems to have really, really hit a chord, and people seem to be liking it, which is great.
Are they selling it in the team shop down at Progressive Field?
We're working on that. That is, it's a long story, but that is a tough nut to crack.
Oh, I know.
Not even because of the Indians. It's because of Major League Baseball. There are all kinds of hurdles you have to jump through and what have you. But, yeah, ideally, yes, that at some point it will be there. But for now, it's everywhere. It's in Barnes & Noble over Northeast Ohio. It's, of course, on Amazon.com. It's actually at Drug Mart's. I think it's at Costco. So it's basically everywhere. You can pretty much find it wherever, or certainly online you can order it wherever, which is good. It's nice to have that availability as well. But yeah, working on some other than
that. I had somebody ask me about it, said they were going down to the park, said, "Can I get that Major League book?" I said, "I don't know, but I'll ask and I'll find out for you." So there you go.
Yep.
JK, have a great weekend, and like everybody, enjoy some Indians 95 and 2015, and you and I will catch up next week, man.
Yes, we will. Looking forward to it.
All right. Have a good one, my friend. Jonathan Knight, the sports writer extraordinaire. And, of course, you guys can check out his stuff for EverybodyHatesCleveland.com and DidTheTribeWinLastNight.com, which, by the way, yes, they did. And today they kick off a series with the Rays. We'll preview all of that here a little bit later on in the show. I'm going to take a break, get you some news, and get Jeff Gorman in on the conversation and shift gears a little bit. We've kind of been, and hey, rightfully so, because it's not their time of the year, but we've been putting the Browns on the back burner during the offseason. Got a little bit of stuff to talk about this week. Minicamp, final one in the books. Now they will go home for a few weeks and get ready for the real deal, training camp. Jeff Gorman is going to talk to us here coming up next about what's going down with the Cleveland Browns this week and more. Jeff Gorman from Browns101.com joining us next here on the Sports Fix. You guys, so much more still to come. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with Jeff Gorman, Browns101.com.
The Sports Fix, your choice for intelligent talk.
That was wonderful.
Bravo.
I loved that.
Oh, it was great.
Intelligent talk.
Well, it was pretty good.
Well, it wasn't bad.
Well, there were parts of it that weren't very good,
though. It could have been a lot better.
I didn't really like it.
These guys must be on the wrong station.
It was pretty terrible.
It was bad.
It was awful.
I was terrible.
Get them away.
Hey, boo.
Boo.
The Sports Fix.
Sports Fix listeners, do you tweet? So do we. So tweet with us 24/7 at the Sports Fix CLE.
How to be a great dad in 15 seconds. Bike ride, go fish, walk in the park, phone call, milkshake, play catch, picnic, fly a kite, tell jokes, laugh, talk, read a story, tell a story, bumper car, swing set, bowling, pillow fight, cut loose, stay tight. Whew. Because the smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today. Call 877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Have you gotten your copy of Cleveland's Finest yet? Highlighting the best moments, players, and media members in Cleveland sports history? In-depth, personal interviews with some of the top names in Cleveland sports fill the pages of this incredible book. Cleveland's Finest by Vince McKee is this year's must-have book for every Cleveland sports fan. Available now at Amazon.com. Get your copy today.
Business owners and professionals, do you want to take your business, your product, your team, your event to the next level? You want to advertise right here with the Sports Fix. Our listeners are among the most loyal listeners, terrestrial or internet. The Sports Fix universe is not only the radio show, but tens of thousands of fans on Facebook and Twitter. Email me, Jerry Myers, thesportsfix@AOL.com. That's thesportsfix@AOL.com. And let me help you swing for the fences and hit it out of the park right here on the Sports Fix.
Portions of the Sports Fix brought to you by Harry Buffalo. Harry Buffalo, join the herd.
News break. Good morning, I'm Bob Picozzi. He finished tied for second at the 2011 U.S. Open. Dustin Johnson is the co-leader at the 2015 Open at Chambers Bay. He won 5-17 Eastern Time today in the second round after shooting a 5-under 65 yesterday.
I thought the setup was great. I thought, They had some really tough flags, and they had some pins that, you know, you could get close to. So I thought they did a good job with the setup.
Also tied at 5-under, Henrik Stenson, who also tees off at 5:17 Eastern time, one stroke back Patrick Reed. He has a late tee time as well. Tiger Woods will tee off in about an hour. He is 10 over. The Nationals should learn more today about the status of right fielder Bryce Harper. He'll be reevaluated after leaving last night's loss to the Rays with what is being described as a mild left hamstring strain. Harper is second in the National League in home runs, third in RBIs, and third in batting. ESPN NBA insider Brian Windhorst is reporting the Cavaliers are shopping the potentially valuable contract of Brendan Haywood, and Paris will officially announce next week it will submit a bid to host the 2024 Olympics.
This summer, Johnsonville reminds everyone to get their sausage family together to enjoy some plump, juicy brats around the grill. Because at Johnsonville, we don't make sausage, we make family and sausage.
You're listening to The Sports Fix.
Oh, what you gonna do? You wanna get down? Tell me. Oh, what you gonna do? Do you wanna get down? Oh, what you gonna do? You wanna get down? Oh, what you gonna do? You wanna get down? Tell me.
Welcome back to the Sports Fix Live as we roll on. J-Rocc back with you, getting ready to be joined in a few moments by my man Jeff Gorman from Indians and Browns 101.com. We're going to talk a little Browns here as they wrap up their final in between the mandatory mini camp here. This one will be the final one before they get a few weeks off here. Was it about 8 weeks off or so? And then they come back 6 weeks or so, and then they're back for training camp and the march to the regular season begins. We're going to talk a little Browns news and notes here with Jeff Gorman from Browns101.com. And we're going to talk to you guys as well on Facebook and Twitter. As always, keep the conversation going. Facebook.com/TheSportsFix. And tweet with us anytime at TheSportsFixCLE, all one word. Facebook.com/TheSportsFix. Tweet with us at TheSportsFixCLE. And as always, you can email us, TheSportsFix@AOL.com. We're getting down on it, not with Cool and the Gang, although they are in the background, but with my man, Jeff Gorman. Let's go to the phones here as soon as I decide to turn him up. Jeff Gorman, my friend, how you doing this Friday afternoon?
I'm doing super, J-Rocc. Can you hear me okay?
There he is. What's up, my friend? I can hear you just fine now.
Everything's going great, you know? I mean, it would be great if we could be talking about a Game 7, but I guess it just wasn't in the cards. You know, I'm really thinking about, you know, back in the 90s, you know, the Bulls and Jordan, you know, they had, took them a while to get over the hump with the Pistons, but once they did, you know, they were off and running. And I think that even though we're a little disappointed with how everything ended with the Cavs, you know, this is really valuable experience for everybody on that roster to go all the way to the finals. And I think it's really going to serve this team well next year, hopefully with a lot more ammunition, a lot more firepower at our disposal.
Absolutely. Absolutely. My man, of course, Jeff, talking about the Cavaliers. That run comes to an end. No heads held down. And you know what? Jeff just said it. My man, Jonathan Knight, said it in the previous segment. Mike Brandenberry said it yesterday. I said this at the early part of the playoff run, and some of you guys argued with me and some of you agreed. But I told you, I said, I know you're not going to want to listen to me now, but when this thing is over, you're going to be salty for a couple of days if they don't win. And that's it. And then you're going to realize what they did and go, wow, yeah, man, I'm good. Let's look forward. And it's not because you're satisfied with being a loser. It's because once the sting of the moment goes away, you'll sit back and really appreciate what we just watched. I agree with you. Can't wait to see what they do here in free agency. You know what? Talking about it, I mentioned that there's been so much Cavs and the Indians as well that for the first time in years, 4 years at least, these really simple football season, the time when you're talking about guys crossing the street without looking both ways because you're running out of things to talk about. It gets so much attention here in Cleveland traditionally, and it hasn't for once because of all the other things to have with the different little things. But now this week, the final Browns actual mini camp, this one, the mandatory veteran mini camp with everybody in, and you really start to see for a minute here what's going to come back into training camp. And there was a lot of good things to come out, I think, on the field that people saw this week as the Browns prepare for their final break before the real deal.
That's right. It's nice to see all of the rookies getting out there and competing and showing, you know, what they're going to do on the roster. And, you know, those names start to become a lot more real when you see them out there and you see what they can do. And, you know, it really puts a lot of pressure on the guys that are there. You have people, you know, who, you know, may have thought that they were pretty much assured of having jobs or having starting positions. Now suddenly, you know, they've got people nipping at their heels, and that's really a good thing, because if there's one thing that the Browns need, it's just, you know, just more talent up and down, you know, up and down the depth chart, because we've seen so many times when we get down to November and December, we're really, you know, scraping the bottom of the barrel as far as who's left, who's healthy, who can go out there and just get on the field, let alone compete and win. And if you want to take that next step, you know, you've got to keep in bringing as much talent as you can. And that's why it's so nice just to see in the draft, you know, just the quantity, including, you know, let alone the quality, just the fact we didn't trade out of any of our picks. We just got a lot of new talent coming in here, and hopefully that quantity will result in some quality. Maybe with some people who we don't even know are going to be doing that well, but maybe some people who could be diamonds in the rough and maybe surprise us a little bit.
That's some of the things that I wanted to talk about. Let's jump right in where you're at there and talk a little bit about the offensive side of the ball with the Cleveland Browns here, because that was one of the biggest changes. You lose your offensive coordinator, you change your starting quarterback, all of the things that we've seen the Browns do here, and really discombobulated offensively in the first few voluntary mini camps that we've seen, as you would expect when a team's putting in a new offensive system, a new workload, a new coordinator, new quarterbacks, all of that. One of the things that I've noticed a lot of people this week praising Josh McCown, not just on the Browns, but a lot of the people that observed practices as well, had a much better grasp of the offense this time, which you would hope to see in your final mini camp out of your quarterback, but gave a lot of people confidence that while this guy is not going to come in and, you know, be Peyton Manning, which you never expect him to be, he will be able to theoretically competently run this offense, get the Browns in and out of the right plays. Many of the same things that they talked about last year with Brian Hoyer being the key from their perspective of what they need out of the quarterback, more than being a hero that saves the day, being able to get the team in and out of the right plays, check off at the line, get your protections right. And it appears from all, at least people that witnessed this week, Josh McCown beginning to at least get a grasp of the Browns' new offense.
Right. And, you know, usually it's a bad thing where we keep running into every year coming in with new offensive coordinators and having to install a whole new system. This year kind of doesn't matter because almost everybody on the offense is new. Almost all the players are new. So it's not like a lot of people, except some of the linemen, are really learning a new system. And, you know, we talk about Hoyer and we talk about Josh McCown, and, you know, everyone was sort of waiting for some other better quarterback to come riding to the rescue, and that never happened. It's like, well, I guess it's McCown. So I think that what we all need to hope for as Browns fans is that McCown can just at least get up to the level that Brian Hoyer was last year in the first half of the season, where he wasn't blowing everybody's doors off, but he was remaining calm, remaining competent, remaining upright, you know, staying in the game, and being able to make enough plays to win. And the Browns did win 7 games. So if we can just maybe, of course, you know, our expectations aren't too high, but maybe we can even lift our expectations a little bit to where McCown can be kind of like Brian Hoyer, and he's not going to throw for 450 yards, but if he can, you know, manage the game, and, you know, I know sometimes it sounds like sort of like a bad word, you know, manage the game. Well, that means you really don't have a very good quarterback. But, you know, that's the situation we're in. You can manage the game or you can mismanage the game. So if he can come out there, not mismanage the game, just give us a chance. If we got this great defense and we have this highly touted secondary, if we can have a quarterback who can just give us a chance, then maybe we've got a chance.
And you know what? That term drives me crazy, the game manager, because
yeah,
to me, if you're a quarterback, that's an intrinsic part of your job. It shouldn't be. Quarterback has to be a gate. You have to be able to manage everything. You should be, like you said, but then again, you could mismanage. But that term does always drive me crazy. And again, the Browns have built an offense where they don't need statue-building performances out of their quarterback. They need competent play. They need them to not turn the ball over, to not put the team into bad positions when they're on the field running the offense, and to allow this team to primarily rely on its running game, which is something else I want to dive into looking at one of the things coming out of this. Of course, Duke Johnson earlier in the week wrapped up his contract. He's in the fold as the Browns got everybody locked up. But that's a guy that has done nothing but get rave reviews here so far in camp for his attitude, for his physical attributes, for his pass-catching ability. And not just Duke Johnson, but I thought it was funny if you listened to the Browns the other day, John DeFilippo and the running backs coach as well, telling some stories from last year relating to the way the kind of toxic relationship that the running backs had with each other. You know how you always want, you say, hey, well, we want competitive guys. We want chippiness. But apparently that was over the line with what the Browns had, which kind of gives you some explanation on why they parted ways mid-season with Ben Tate the way they did, is apparently it went beyond, I'm better than you. No, I'm better than you. Let's prove it on the field. And these guys would take it into the locker room. They would take it. The competition went to a point that it stopped being beneficial and started damaging the team as a whole. And that was one of the reasons why they had to move Ben Tate out of the way, besides the fact that clearly there were some other issues on the physical side. But that was an issue. And here now you've got an interesting dynamic because you've got two guys who are the incumbents, but they're just second-year players in Crowell and West. And then you've got another rookie in Duke Johnson. And don't forget Glenn Winston in the equation as well. Four talented backs, and that's not even touching a couple of the fullback options that the Browns brought in. But interesting to see how they work together, but apparently much more of a teamwork dynamic coming out of the running back room this year. But start with Duke Johnson. What are your thoughts, man? I mean, he has definitely shown the ability to catch the ball out of the backfield at a different level than any of the other backs so far on the roster.
Well, I think that's really going to be the difference, because last year that was one element of this offense really didn't have, which is throwing the ball to your running backs. Of course, every offense should have that. And, of course, we go up against other teams and they end up killing us with that. But that was something that we really couldn't do. It's not that it was impossible. It's just that these rookie running backs, they were just getting their feet wet as far as running the ball itself. So as far as, you know, if you expect them to catch the ball too much, that's a little too much to put on those rookies. But now, the thing I like is you've really got room for all three of the running backs that you've mentioned. You've got West, you've got Crowell, and even though Duke Johnson was pretty much the bell cow running back down there at Miami, Florida, he's not going to be asked to do 9, 25, 30 times a game. And that's going to be really good from a presentation standpoint, and just because he'll be able to throw something different at the defense. You can let West and Crowell the tough yardage, and then you can let Duke Johnson run loose. In fact, during practice, they were lining him up a wide receiver just to really, you know, screw things around with the defense and to show a lot of different options. And, you know, that's not even counting what he could do as a punt returner or a kick returner. So I think that Duke Johnson is really an exciting player. I'm really looking forward to what he can do. And I don't think he threatens Terrence West or Isaiah Crowell as well. I think all three of those guys can really come together and maybe become a strength of this team.
I mean, that's one of the things, and I'm not going to do too much of going back and second-guessing last year, but it's one of the things that we all noticed, I think, the lack of use. I mean, 29 receptions for your running backs last year, the lack of use of the running backs in the passing game. But when Mac went down and when the dynamic offensively changed and teams were starting to squish down and shorten the field and really put the pressure on the Browns, I was more amazed that they weren't, because what it's not just, oh, hey, pass it to your running backs and you can gain a few yards or whatever. But when you just completely don't do it, it's one thing if it's a limited part of your offense, but when teams just know that you're not going to pass to the backs, A, they can sneak another guy up to the line. B, they can cheat on their defenses a little bit because they know that the rare the odds are very small that you're going to catch them by surprise with the back catching a pass. So maybe they cheat a guy who's supposed to be watching the back, and maybe he's able to jump a route or cut off a run, whatever the option may be. So you just limit yourself so many different ways, and you've got to think just adding that back in, you instantly make life easier, whether it's Brian Hoyer, whether it's for Josh McCown, for Johnny Manziel, for Connor Shaw. You're going to make life easier on yourself and on those guys. And then when you translate it to a specific person like Duke Johnson, that's his skill set, and that's something that he brings to the table, along with his ability to do a little bit of kick returning and play in the special teams game as well. But that's going to be a completely different thing. I mean, really, it was not, think about that, 29 receptions last year for the Browns running back in 16 games, brother. That is less than 2 receptions per game by the running back.
Right, because what you're basically telling the defense is, don't worry about it. It's not going to happen. And that's what you got to do. You got to keep the defense guessing. Have them worry about it. Have them say, you know, we can't just take our outside linebackers and just, you know, say, go after that quarterback. Go after that piece of meat. They've got to watch out for the guy coming out of the backfield. And that's something that they haven't had to worry about. And just to be able to throw something else at him would be great. And it doesn't just have to be Duke Johnson, you know, but if you can just have that be something that's in the back of the defense's mind, I think that's really going to help.
Yeah, I agree with you, and that's something that I'm interested in seeing when we get to training camp, when we get to preseason games, and we start to see the offense begin. It's not going to be this beautiful poetry in motion type offense, but it can definitely be functional, and it can rely on what I think is going to be the top, one of the top 2 or 3 offensive lines in football. I really do believe that that is going to be an optimum strength of the Browns, and they're going to be able to rely on that, and it's going to make Josh McCown better than he is. It's going to make the receiving core better than they are as well. And by picking up getting in there and getting Irving and picking up really a guy that could play multiple positions on the line, you give yourself now some flexibility that if something happens to a guy, it doesn't instantaneously tank your whole season. I really am interested to see in the other side of the field because, you know, earlier in the show, JK and I were talking about dominant teams and teams like the, you know, we were talking about those 95 Indians and this Cavaliers run, the different types of teams that they were. They were a dominant team defensively, and then they had to change their identity along the way. This team's identity is not going to change this season. It is going to be built for the Cleveland Browns on the defensive side of the ball, and they're using some big words. You hear the secondary, particularly this week, coming out and thinking that they and saying, hey, we're putting our claim down that we're one of the top 2 secondaries in all of football. And I know you've got to go out there and repeat it on the field, but I tend to agree with the thought that they could be that good because we saw bits and pieces of it last year. You've added, you know, Pierre Desir is going to get multiple more opportunities and be healthy. Tremont Williams. I mean, you've added a lot of depth. Justin Gilbert was practically invisible last year. I mean, add that to what you've got going. Joe Hayden and those guys and Gibson and Whitner and the safeties. I agree. The Browns should have one of the top 2 or 3 defensive backfields in football.
Nice to know that we've got some kind of strength, some kind of advantages, because there are teams that we've had in the past that have been, you know, didn't have anything, didn't have any sources of strength, didn't have any strong suits. And, you know, I'm glad to hear that the secondary is starting to talk, starting to say, you know, this is a point of pride for us. We're going to try to be one of the best secondaries in the league. You know, that's a very good point. You know, I think some of the best secondaries are the ones to play in January. Like, yeah, that's what I like to hear, too. I like to hear the coaches come back and say that. So the fact that we've got, you know, because we've had some teams that have been so bereft of talent that it's nice that we're in a situation where, you know, we've got an offensive line that can be considered one of the best. We've got a secondary that can be considered one of the best. And now the job now is to leverage those strengths. You know, obviously it would be great if we had a wonderful team that was just strong for all up and down. And there's the teams that end up playing in the Super Bowl. But, you know, how do we get our offensive line to make our whole offense better? How do we get our secondary to make our whole defense better and also to mask some of the weaknesses, especially, you know, if we have weaknesses in the linebackers, the defensive line? How can we leverage that strength in the secondary to, you know, hide those weaknesses and get a better overall product just so we can at least try to approach an 8-8 season? You know, I mean, we were 7-9 last year. You know, it obviously fell apart at the end, so it almost seems like an uphill battle just to get to that this year. But we at least have got some areas of this team that have, you know, something, you know, have some can do something positive. So, and that's what the coaches have to think into wins on the football field.
See, I think you're much more describing the offense, though, than the defense, because just because I started with the secondary doesn't mean I'm done. I believe that the secondary being the strength for this defense that they are, that's really going to beef up the front seven as well. I think the Browns are poised. I don't know how far offensively this team will come along this year, but I believe that the Browns are poised defensively to be one of the top 5 to 7 defenses overall in the NFL this season. I think the pass rush will be stronger because of this backup secondary, the backfield that we're talking about. And you said something earlier that switches right into what we're talking about now, finding players. And I'm going to mention a guy I saw, Pat McManaman on ESPN, actually did a piece on him this week. When the first voluntary minicamp happened a month or two back, I mentioned Scott Solomon as somebody that was all over the place and really made an impact on the coaches, to where I mentioned him as somebody that I think is going to end up taking significant time away from some people on defense, and he's going to not only make this team, but he's going to play. The Browns, I could tell, he's going to take snaps from Mingo. He's going to take some snaps at outside linebacker. He is a guy, when you mentioned earlier, guys that you don't expect that are going to come out here. I said before the draft, right after the draft, I thought 5 or 6 undrafted, unheard of guys are going to be a part of this roster, because the Browns are following that trend of knowing how hungry those guys are, finding those guys and using them to build the depth of their roster. I think Scott Solomon's another guy. This guy's been cut 4 or 5 different times, never been a starter in the NFL. He's in his he's heading into his 4th season here. And that's a guy that has gotten the attention of the Browns here, and perhaps that's a name that 2 months from now we're talking about being in the mix for getting some starting reps there after coming out of practically nowhere at the first set of minicamps.
And that's what we like to see. We like to see talent coming from different sources. I mean, you can draft the best people you want, but, you know, the real successful teams like the Seahawks, like the Packers, like even the Giants in the past have, you know, been able to unearth some talent that sort of comes out of nowhere, and it's like, hey, why is nobody giving this guy any credit? This guy can really play football. And sometimes they don't have some of the physical tangibles. They have the intangibles, but sometimes they don't have the physical prowess, you know, that shows up, you know, in combines and things like that. But, you know, they have an instinct for football. They have an instinct for the ball. You're talking about defense. Somebody who can go after the ball carrier, you know, and they end up, you know, translating, you know, into making plays and making big plays that are going to stop a team on third down and stuff like that. So I kind of like what I'm seeing as far as him coming in and maybe challenging, you know, someone like Barkevious Mingo. And that's what they said. They said Mingo's really going to have to work hard just to get his playing time. And that just shows, you know, what the situation is with really this entire team. You know, being a first-round draft pick really only buys you about a couple of years as far as, you know, honeymoon or grace period in order to, you know, to become, you know, a solid contributor on the team. If you're in your third year and you're not really, you know, making that step to becoming, you know, a mainline starter, then, you know, you're in trouble. And that's the situation that Johnny Manziel and Justin are going to need to make enough progress this year so that next year, you know, they're really contributing at a level that is acceptable. Because, you know, being a number one draft pick, again, doesn't really buy you that much time anymore. It's going to have to be time to produce.
Absolutely. And you bring up Mingo there, and I'll go right to him. I'm willing to go so far as to say that I think Mingo, this is a make-or-break season. This is a make-or-break training camp for him. I think he finds a spot. Part of my gut, some of you guys are going to jump when I say this, but I honestly think that he's in a challenge to make this roster at the end of training camp. I honestly do. Not because of anything necessarily against him as much as other people coming in and surpassing him on this depth chart. You've noticed that they went after some more pass rushers in the draft and in their offseason moves here this year. So, Solomon, here's a guy we're mentioning right there. Look at the difference between how the Browns are talking about a guy who's been on five teams in 3 years and never been a starter. Jim O'Neill calling him a heat-seeking missile coming off the edge, and how he's definitely not only going to make the team, but he's going to be a big part of what they do on defense. And then you talk about a guy who was the number six pick in the draft a few years ago, and you're having him cover linebackers and talk about him much more in a way you would talk about a much more generic skill set type linebacker than what you would expect out of a top 10 impact pick type player as Barkevious Mingo. That tells me that he's going to be fighting for a backup linebacker spot, you know, a rotational spot here this training camp. And that's a best case, in my opinion, I think, unless he comes out here and blows the doors down. But the Browns are not encouraged by what they've seen from him so far. And I'll be willing to say, if that's the best case for him, this will be the final season, absolutely, for Barkevious Mingo. But I think don't put it against the realm of possibility that he does not end up not making the final roster for this team, depending on what he looks like when he gets to camp. Of course, I'm not writing the guy off, but I think that's where the Browns' mindset is, that Mingo could be one of those guys that is a, wow, they cut their first-round pick from a couple years ago at the end of camp.
Yeah, it's the good thing is he knows what he's up against. He's definitely put up or shut-up time for him, and he's going to have to produce, so he's not going to be really caught by surprise with this. If he's got the talent, he's going to have to show it. And, you know, it's kind of hard because it's not like he's slacked or he hasn't done well. He was really banged up and was really hurt throughout the season last year. He played injured, which is what you want players to do. You want them to be out there, you know, battling, you know, fighting through injury. But the problem is we just didn't really get to see what he could do because it was like he was playing with one arm most of the time. And the thing with Mingo is he's not that big of a guy to begin with. I mean, we saw when we drafted him that there were size issues with him. It was like, wow, is this guy going to be able to hold up, you know, against these big, tough, you know, these big, tough running backs coming at him all the time? So he's really up against it. He's going to have to, you know, he bulked up a little bit last year. He might have to bulk up a little bit more in order to, you know, just, again, because he's not just fighting the other team. He's fighting just to get a spot on this team. And that's one good thing is, you know, if you've got people who are challenging, if you've got people who are knocking your number one draft picks out of their job, then that means that you are bringing in some talent. You've got some guys coming in, for like you said, from different sources. So that may mean, you know, as we were talking about everything today, it may seem like, you know, the talent level of the Browns may be slowly, you know, slowly starting to increase, even if it's not always at the, you know, high marquee positions that we all salivate over.
For sure, and I love Barkevious Mingo. I love the grit that he showed. Hey, that's a term we fell in love with the Cavs here. I love that, like you said, the playing injured, and I want him to make it. But driving competition for so long, it's been, you know, if you show up and you've got a modicum level of talent, you're guaranteed to be a part of whatever the Browns are putting together. Just good enough isn't good enough anymore, man.
Right, exactly.
And I'm there. I'm there exactly. But I want to see Mingo fight it. But if not, it's good to see. And that's something that's going to be interesting is here we are, as like I said, what, 6-8 weeks away? And then they'll come back. Everybody will get their self fresh and come back for the real deal here. And then we'll start the training camp run. And Johnny Manziel's coming, but he will be leaving two things behind when he comes back, by the way. He did his first media appearance this week and really – as really he should have. So I'm not going to, like, go, wow, I'm so proud of what he did. This is what you had to do. Come out and say, A,
right.
no more money sign. No, because you're just asking for that to get thrown back at you at this point. And B, no more Johnny football. Yeah, absolutely. And no more Johnny football. And he talked about how he was an ass and he got caught up into the persona of being that guy and being a celebrity and being an ass and doing all the things that he did. And he had no choice but to own up to that. Part of it is, I think, you don't have any choice based on the way it looks and the reality of it. The other part is, I really think that the physical side of the NFL is humbling Johnny Manziel. And that is not meant in a slight. That's not meant as a joke. I think that his inability to make it happen last year really opened his eyes, and then he thought, okay, it's my fault. I'm going to go to rehab. I'm going to straighten my focus. But I think what really has opened Johnny Manziel's eyes to reality is after rehab, coming back and still having difficulty continuing to adapt to the NFL, because at that point now, you have to begin to question the skill set that got you there. And you can hear it in his voice. I'm just happy to be here. I'm just happy to have a spot, because I don't think – I thought it was just lip service at the end of last season when he said it. I know it was just lip service at the end of last season. But now I hear it in his voice. I think a guy – that realizes I may not be good enough to play at this level, and I'm just happy for the opportunity that I have.
Right. And, you know, if you think about how he was in college, you know, it worked for him. The swagger, the, you know, the money sign, the, you know, the nickname, he wins the Heisman Trophy his freshman year. Of course, you're going to have everything thrown at you, everything but money in the college, all the accolades thrown at you. And the first thing he's going to do is, I'm going to go to the pros, and I'm going to see if I can just be the same way. This is Paul around. I'm running around. I'm flashing the money sign. You know, this is me. This is Johnny Football. And, if that would have worked, if he would have, set the NFL, if he would have wrecked this league, as he said, on a draft day, then we wouldn't be having this conversation, because he would be, he'd be Johnny Football, and we'd all be, cheering for him, just like we've been cheering for LeBron. But obviously that didn't work for a lot of reasons. Unfortunately, he's got himself personally, he got his act together, just so he has the chance to do it physically, to do it mentally in the NFL. So he's been able to, hopefully he can continue in the summer to keep his nose clean. I have a good feeling about it. I think he's going to be all right. But obviously his act in college didn't play anymore, and I'm glad that he's made the proper adjustment.
We'll see. We'll see if that sticks, and we'll see if it applies on the field as well. Like I said, we're in the countdown. The next time we're talking about the Browns being back on the field, they'll gather for training camp, and they'll get themselves rolling into the preseason and all of that. Jeff Gorman, my man, it's been a fun – man, I mean, really, it just seems like yesterday the season ended. It's because of those Cavaliers. They kept us running. I was joking with JK earlier. I said, man, here we go. We look up from the playoffs. We got a couple weeks of baseball, and then boom, real football.
Boom.
Well, kind of real football is upon us again, but it's off and running. So hopefully the Cavs make a habit out of this, keeping us occupied until about the third week of June.
Yeah, I love it. Meaningful basketball, all in the middle of June. I could really get used to this. They bought the Indians a lot of time, which they unfortunately haven't been able to capitalize on. But yeah, if we can get these seasons extended like this, maybe even with a better result, that's something that I would really like to see over the next several years. That would be just a beautiful thing.
You know what? I just got to mention something, because I talked about this earlier, and I said I think one of my favorite things going to the Cavs, since we just mentioned it, about what David Griffin said yesterday, was the bogusness of the narrative about David Blatt, and how when people make up, when the story's made up and when it's all speculation, you never have to own up to it. You never have to back down from it. You can just repeat the story. I brought up Brian Windhorst, a couple weeks ago when they point blank, he asked Kevin Love, are you coming back with the Cavs? And Kevin Love said, yes, sir, I am. And the next story that Brian Windhorst wrote started out with the words, despite what Kevin Love says, there's still belief that he's leaving Cleveland. And I'm like, wait a minute. Now we've gotten to the point where we can say, ask a guy a question, and then after he answers it, we can go, since we didn't like the answer you gave, we can just say, despite what he just said, here's our pure speculation. Well, here's why I bring that up. Because it just happened again. As my news feed pops up here, I get those little alerts on my phone as the show's going on. And yesterday, Skip Bayless and Stephen A. Smith both said, gun to our heads, David Blatt is out as the Cavaliers coach before the press conference. Now, obviously, we know that didn't happen. So today, Stephen A. Smith, his latest piece, says, it appears that Blatt will coach the Cavs next year, but it's only because David Griffin is such a strong supporter. Whether that's the best decision still has to be seen. And it's like, that's his way of saying, hey, I know I reported something that's completely false, but it's going to be true. Just wait and see here. Just don't let reality fool you here. It's like the opposite of the Wizard of Oz. It's like, ignore the people in front of the curtain. Pay attention to the little man behind the curtain that's pulling the strings or something, you know? I swear.
Right.
That drives me nuts. Like, yesterday, Bruce Drennan made a mistake. He should have never went on air with the report that he did. I don't know if you saw it, but like 30 seconds before the press conference, he jumps on his show and he goes, "I was just told that David Blatt is about to resign as a coach of the Cavs." And then they flip to the press conference and nothing of the sort happens. Now, I can understand getting bad information and it's his fault for not double check. I mean, seriously, it would have took you 2 seconds to call the Cavs and go, "Hey, is David Blatt resigning in 30 seconds?" Somebody would have gave you a heads up, you know. But that's different than what Windhorst and Stephen A. and these guys do, because they don't just take a story. They make a story. Then they twist the story that they made up. Then they repeat that story enough that people believe it's true. And if you don't like it, they'll make up a new one tomorrow that fits what they told you today.
Right. Well, there's a couple things there. One is you've got these guys who are talking heads on TV, and they're just trying to fill up tons of time. They're trying to come up with something interesting to talk about when there's not really a game going on. And the other thing is there's all this, you know, competition, and the focus isn't on getting the story first. And people will jump the gun to try and, it's not just like, "Oh, this big thing happened." It's like, "As so-and-so reported," you know, because if anybody else comes out and says it, you've got to give credit to that reporter who broke the story first. And it's big pats on the back and big kudos to whoever broke the story first. Really, as a journalist, your job is just to get it right. Make sure you get it right. And when you're jumping all over yourself to get out there and be first, then you get the sort of Dewey defeats Truman moment that we saw here.
Well, that's just it. In today's, it's not about getting it right anymore. It's all about getting it first. You hit that dead on the center of the nail. That's all it's about, is how quick can I tweet it? How quick can I post it? How quick can I refeed it? And then boom. And like I say all the time, my favorite example is you see it all the time. When you look at these stories that go out on Bleacher Report or even ESPN, wherever you get your news from, and most of the time, you'll read a story that tells you that some unnamed person told another unnamed person who told this person. And if you trace these stories back, they all trace back to speculation stories. Like, none of them.
Right.
It's like they don't start from a sort. Like, if there's a legit story and then somebody wants to opinionate about it, and I write a blog, and I go, "Based on what I read on CBSNews.com, this is what's going on with the Cavs." And it at least goes back to a real story where CBS News said, "Cavaliers say that they may be investigating their options in free agency." Bam. That's a real news source and a real print media. But what these guys do is, if you ever read these stories, especially on those more generic sites like Bleacher Report, it'll be according to this story. But then when you click on that story, it's another speculation piece that was according to this story. And you go, "Man, I keep clicking back, but there's no first story that actually verifies any of this stuff." And I'm like, it's the truth that on Twitter and in today's society, if enough people relink the initial story, it just becomes a fact no matter what.
Right. I mean, I don't want to pile too much on Bleacher Report because I did actually work there for 5 years as an editor.
I'm
but
just,
one of the things that has sort of come out as far as like the way the sausage is made, quote unquote, is Bleacher Report, you know, they study, you know, what people are talking about and searching for on Google, and then they write stories based on that. It's like, "Hey, this is what people are searching for. Write a story about it." And that's really the tail wagging the dog. You're supposed to be finding the news and reporting it, not following the news and then writing it afterwards, like, "Hey, this is what people want to hear," because then you're chasing a story that might, like you said, might not really be there.
You know what you just described? Have you guys ever watched that garbage TMZ half-hour show that they put on TV, where basically they gather their pack of jackal reporters together and they do exactly what you just said? They go, "Hey, Tom Cruise is in the news this week." And then somebody goes, "Hey, I caught Tom Cruise using the bathroom outside the Chinese restaurant the other day. He didn't like me being there." But that's what they do. They do exactly what you just said. They go, "Okay, LeBron's in the news today. You, go follow LeBron around and find a story. And you, You right. go follow. And it's like, I hate that. That TMZ level of journalism, I cannot stand it. That show drives me nuts because it's literally a bunch of guys, the kind of people that'll dig through your garbage and see what you ate for lunch so that they could spend 5 seconds on TV going, hey, I followed LeBron James to lunch and he ate a banana. You know, like, what the hell, man? So, anyways, but Jeff Gorman, we went off on the beaten trail there. Thank you for joining us, wrapping up the Browns week of minicamps. You and I will talk on Tuesday about the Indians. Oh, they'll be in the mouth of the Tigers here. Hopefully not figuratively and literally in the mouth of the Tigers, but we'll see how things are going and how they come out of this weekend. You excited? 95 Tribe in town and Tribe and the Rays. It should be some fun times down at the corner of Carnegie and Ontario this weekend.
Yes, let's hope that the 95 Indians can kind of give the rub to this year's Indians to get something going. We sort of won a 2 out of 3 kind of series with all the rain and switching venues and stuff. We did actually take 2 out of 3 from a good Cubs team, and now we got a good Rays team coming in, and then you said into the mouth of the Tigers. You know, like we said a few days ago, you know, the Indians don't have much time to turn this around, but it can be done. I just hope we have something positive and not something ultimately depressing when we talk about the Tribe on Tuesday.
Sounds good. Jeff, enjoy your weekend. And hey, happy Father's Day, my friend. Enjoy your weekend, and you and I will catch up on Tuesday.
Thanks. Happy Father's Day to you too, my man. You have a good one. Thank you.
You got it. Jeff Gorman, you guys can check him out, as always, Indians101 and Browns101.com. And he's here every Tuesday and Friday on the Sports Fix. We're going to take a break, final break. Come on back. Set the stage for the weekend. Talk about, hey, you got the Tribe Series this weekend. We'll look at the starters. Hey, famous thing happened in the NBA draft. You may have heard of the guy that was drafted on this day in history. We'll talk about that. Gladiators getting back at it. We'll talk about all of that. Tiger Woods, man, that is unbelievable. I'm a Tiger Woods guy, as you guys know, and I'm just saddened seeing the shell of Tiger Woods that's left out there. Another 80 plus round of Tiger. It's sad. And I know some people don't like him. Some people don't. I get it, but I do, even though he's made some mistakes. But we'll talk about all of that, set the stage for the weekend and more. Don't go anywhere. Final segment of The Fix coming up next.
And now, a very special announcement from the Sports Fix.
Black bears weigh between 200 and 500 pounds. Brown bears weigh between 300 and over 1,000 pounds. Black bears run away from you. Brown bears run at you. When attacked by a bear, simply lie still on the ground and cover your face and head with your hands. When the bear is finished batting you around and mauling you, contact the U.S. Forest Service.
And that was a message from the Sports Fix.
Guys, want to take just a second as we head into this break and remind you about the official business printing source of the Sports Fix, our friends at Signs and Ship. Signs and Ship, I'm telling you, Chris and Pam, they've taken care of me since day one, and they can do the same for you. Whether you're a small business that's already been established and you're looking to grow to that next level and expand your business, or perhaps you've got an idea that you just know is going to be a great business and you need to figure out how to brand it and how to promote it and put it out there, Signs and Ship is the place for you. If you need a logo, they can create one for you. They have a fantastic graphic designer. Business cards, signs, banners, yard signs, mobile advertising, anything you can think of that you need to promote your business, they've got it at Signs and Ship. The best thing about them, too, is each of their locations, whether it's the home base here in Elyria, Ohio, that I work with, or their spots in Virginia, Florida, and Pennsylvania, it's all local sourced. Very important to me because we all understand that small business is the lifeblood of the community. So check them out, signsandship.com, or call Chris and Pam today, 440-323-6060, the home office in Elyria, Ohio. Signs and Ship, quality printing at affordable prices.
It's the Sports Fix. We'll be right back.
Fantasy sports lovers, you put so much time, hard work, and effort into playing week to week that it quickly stops being a fantasy and starts getting real. Real time spent making real decisions, creating real victory.
I'm the greatest man in the world!
And when the smoke clears, you want to show off those victories with a real prize.
I mean, a really real prize. Yeah.
Nobody does that like Fantasy Jocks. The crew over at Fantasy Jocks have beautiful, high-quality, and heavy-duty championship belts, rings, trophies, and so much more for all your fantasy sports needs.
The trophy's 12 feet high, and it is glorious!
Football, baseball, hoops, you name it, they have it. Plus, they have awesome draft kits and party supplies to make all your preseason activities the envy of everyone. If your league needs a ring, belt, or trophy, or you want to upgrade what you already have, there's literally only one place to go. If you're going to be a fantasy jock, do it right.
It's mine, the most magnificent belt ever created, and it's mine.
With America's Fantasy Sports Superstore, fantasyjocks.com. No football? No problem at Harry Buffalo North Olmsted. Single Cavaliers and Buckeye hoops games in full HD.
Kyrie's supposed to D, goes inside. Teardrops it home right down Euclid.
That's way up in there for two.
The excitement never stops. Every day of the week brings a different set of food and amazing drink specials.
And now,
fans, Harry Buffalo North Olmsted is the home for every UFC pay-per-view live on the big screens.
Let's get it all!
And let's not forget their mouth-watering trademark, the Bison Burger.
They sure are good.
Nobody does bison like Harry Buffalo. The perfect combination of healthy and delicious.
Hey there, eat up, y'all. Use this good church-going folk. Y'all deserve a little treat.
What are you waiting for? Get to Harry Buffalo, just outside Great Northern Mall today. Harry Buffalo, Harry Buffalo. Join the herd.
Join the herd.
Hi, this is Dean Chenoweth, head coach of Cleveland's Lake Erie Monsters, and you're listening to the Sports Fix.
Well, that makes two things I need to take out of the spot log for next week. Dean Chenoweth, no longer head coach of the Lake Erie Monsters because the whole thing switched around, as we know. But it was always fun talking to Coach Chenoweth and looking forward to seeing the next iteration of the Lake Erie Monsters as they take the ice. And hey, speaking of compatriots at the Quicken Loans Arena, as we get back into the show, J-Rocc back with you here and the Sports Fix wrapping it up. 216-539-7535. Phones open all weekend long if you guys want to give us a call about anything you heard here or talk to us on Facebook and Twitter, facebook.com/thesportsfix. Tweet with us at thesportsfixcle. Everybody still basking in the back end and the tailwinds of the Cavaliers coming oh so close to being the NBA champions as they fall short. And the celebration continues at the queue as the Gladiators are going to honor their compatriots at the building. It's Cavaliers night tonight at Quicken Loans Arena, Friday night, 7 p.m. kickoff. Larry Nance, Elmore Smith, Bingo Smith, several Cavaliers legends are going to be in the house signing autographs for fans free before the game. The Gladiators are going to be wearing their wine and gold alternate Cavs-themed jerseys. The Monsters do that as well during the season. And they're going to auction them off after the game, so you may get your chance to put one of those jerseys in your hands. You got dollar sodas, $2 beers, all kinds of different things. It's a military ID night, as always, Friday night, Cavaliers night tonight. And it's going to be on television. If you've never had a chance to check out the Glads and you don't want to go down to the queue, check them out on Channel 43 tonight, 7 p.m. kickoff. They're looking for the old three-game sweep of the Tampa Bay Storm. They've taken the first two in the series this season. They did the same thing last week to the New Orleans Voodoo. They took all three against them. Tampa Bay's coming in on a victory. Gladiators coming in on back-to-back wins, looking to make it three in a row for the first time this year. They're 2-3 at home this season. Tampa Bay, meanwhile, 1-3 on the road, hasn't won back-to-back games all season. The wine and gold clad Gladiators looking to get the victory tonight, get themselves that much closer as they're 7-5, three games out of first place in the division, looking to go to 8-5 with the victory. As I said tonight, you could hear it on the radio, on the television. Kenny Rhoda, Doug Plagans doing the call of the game, and the Gladiators honoring the Cleveland Cavs. They're going to do all the Cavs things during the game, the entertainment options and all of that. They're going to make it a celebration of all things Cavs tonight at the queue, and that's good. They deserve that. And I like the idea. We were talking about this. Somebody brought it up yesterday, but I'd be all about a I'm not saying throw a second place parade for the Cavs, but I do think there should be some kind of a civic get-together, because this city would love to just say thank you, Cavs, I think, collectively, for the effort that they gave, most definitely gave, throughout that 50-some-plus day playoff run, however long that one was. There's big things going on all weekend. You got the Gladiators starting it at the queue. The Indians as well, down at Progressive Field, starting that three-game series with the Tampa Bay Rays. And the 95 Indian Celebration Weekend is tonight. Carlos Carrasco will be on the mound against Nathan Carnes for the Indians. 7:10 is the first pitch. You'll have a bunch of the 95 Indians guys down there tonight. All of them will be there tomorrow for the game, but there'll be several players down there tonight. Matter of fact, I think before the game, Carlos Baerga and Alvaro Espinoza are going to be in the one set. As a matter of fact, they've got Jim Thome, Kenny Lofton, several of those guys raising the flag tonight to celebrate. They're putting up the flag in the building after the game for the 95 American League title run. And, of course, it's Dollar Dog Night and fireworks tomorrow. The whole crew's here. They've got the event at Playhouse Square. I know my man Bruce is going to check that out. The alumni Q&A. They're going to watch the Indians 95 movie, Wahoo, What a Finish. The pregame ceremony. They're giving away those awesome GV artwork t-shirts, specific in-house for the 95 championship run. It's a fireworks night as well. Corey Kluber on the mound against Erasmo Ramirez, so can't ask for more than that. Then they cap it off on Sunday, Trevor Bauer. No, actually, they made the switch. That's going to be Anderson, I believe, who is set to get the start on Sunday so that Trevor Bauer can be saved to take on Detroit on Monday. So kids run the base day and all that. Should be a hell of a lot of fun. Always a great time when the 95 tribe comes back together. This is the official celebration for them here this weekend. I wish I could be down there Saturday to check it out. I had several invitations to go and be part of all the VIP stuff, and I can't, because for those of you looking for something else to do, maybe you're not going to the queue, maybe you're not going to the Jake or whatever, come on down and check me out. I will be wrestling, baby, live and in living color. A huge event this weekend at the Odeon Concert Club, the reestablished Odeon, world famous, down at the Old River Road in the Flats. It's Saturday night, 7 o'clock is bell time. You can check it out on our Facebook or go to the Odeon's website. But I'll be down there. A couple of ECW legends will be there for you wrestling fans, Sabu and the franchise Shane Douglas. I will be there. First time I've wrestled in downtown Cleveland proper in years, I will tell you that. Going to be a big party, so come on down, check it out at the Odeon Concert Club tomorrow night in the Flats. 7 p.m. is the first bell, and I'm looking forward to matching up with Brian Bowers. It's going to be a lot of fun. Looking forward to meeting up with some of you guys. I know a couple dozen of you guys have told me over the last few weeks that you're coming down. Some of you already got your tickets, so make sure you come over and holler at your boy at the merchandise table and all that, although I may be in a bad mood tomorrow. I may not be, you know, in the mood to be nice to people, but I'll still give you a little head nod if you tell me you're from the Sports Fix. So come on out and check that out. Check out the Gladiators. Check out the Indians all weekend long. A lot of stuff to do here in Cleveland. Of course, Father's Day on Sunday. Happy Father's Day to all of you guys out there that are so inclined to be in that category. A lot of stuff going on this weekend. And hey, speaking of going on right now, just quickly, I mentioned it before the break. I'm one of them guys that just cannot stand to see. I don't want to say the greats hang on too long. I don't know if that's what we're talking about or just whatever, but I hate to see it. I was always a Tiger Woods guy. Think about this. 15 years ago was the 2000 U.S. Open run where Tiger Woods just annihilated. I mean, that was when I was, you know, that was at the peak of his powers, that 2000 run. What he ran it by 15-plus strokes. I mean, just destroyed the course. That was really the peak of Tiger Woods' powers there, man. The beginning of his run where he was just truly the most dominant player in the world and was looking like he would be the greatest ever. That was 15 years ago. This same tournament, he opened up yesterday with an 80. 10 over par, second straight tournament that the great Tiger Woods has shot a round in the 80s. And I say that because he is great, whether you like him or dislike him, some of his personal things, his attitude is, I get it. Some people think karma is a bitch and it comes around and gets him. And a lot of people think he paid the price for being, that's fine. But at the end of the day, on the field, the sport, the court, whatever you want to say, he's the man among men. But now, 2008 was the last time he's won a tournament. I mean, you are now real. I mean, at this point, you go, forget, is he going to win another tournament? Is he going to challenge Jack Nicklaus' record? Is he ever going to turn back into, I mean, you keep seeing pieces of the Tiger Woods of old, and then he comes back and drops one of these here. And I mean, just the last tournament he played, the Jack Nicklaus Memorial, how fitting. He drops his worst score ever as a pro, an 85. And here he is now just trying to make the cut today. He's getting, I mean, they're mocking him. I saw ESPN was joking about the fact that the 15-year-old Cole Hammer, who, by the way, has an incredibly cool marketing name for a golfer. I'm just saying, Cole Hammer, tell me that you couldn't do something with that. But anyways, he may beat out Tiger Woods, 15-year-old kid here. Remember when Tiger Woods was the underage prodigy coming up and then going through Stanford? And that seems like generations ago to this Tiger Woods. And I just think it's brought up even more, like, fitting, not fitting, but more poignantly, because it's the 15th anniversary of when he just absolutely annihilated Pebble Beach, embarrassed the world, and he had one of his most embarrassing rounds ever yesterday. And I hate to see it. I would really love to see Tiger Woods get it together and have one and go win more of the go up. But then again, in too far is it's Babe Ruth at the end. That's around the bases. And some of the pictures, the selfies that people have taken, and not the same Tiger Woods, mentally, physically, or anything, in watching the greats fall. And I think in certain circumstances, it's understandable. Tiger Woods was so good. To me, at whatever you do, whatever it is, whether it's working at a factory, whether it's digging a ditch, whether it's being a pro wrestler, whether it's being a golfer, whether it's being a radio sports talk guy, whatever it is that you do, I mean, the you know, you work hard enough to be the best at it. It's only one can be that. And I mean, he was so great. I hate to see people. You guys know, I argue with you guys about guys like Cabrera because I love greatness, whether it plays for my team or somebody else's team. And I appreciate seeing things that you're never going to see again. And I don't know that we'll ever see anybody have a run again. We will, because they said that about Nicklaus, and then along came Tiger, and next will be perhaps one of these young guns that's up here now. But to be that dominant, that good for that long, it'll be a long time. And I just hate to see him limp out. I mean, honestly, I know I'm just repeating myself. I just hate to see it, and I'd love to see him, and he just hasn't been able to. I mean, at some point, does he pull the plug? What do you think? What do you think is more likely to happen in the next year? Tiger Woods wins a tournament, or Tiger Woods announces his retirement? See, you're at the risk of playing for the sake of money, playing for the sake of corporations. And I just wonder how long Tiger Woods, the competitor, can continue to drag himself out there if he truly feels that it's not going to get any better. Because this, like one of those, I'm embarrassed to look at this Tiger Woods. I'm not saying that. I feel bad because of how great he was, and I'd love to see him get the chance to be great one more time. I don't know if he will or not, but that's just me. Anyways, that's it, man. We're getting ready to get out of here. As I said, this weekend, go check out the Tribe. Check out the Gladiators. Come check me out Saturday night at the Odeon. It's going to be a great show. Check it out Saturday night, 7 p.m., Odeon Concert Club in the Flats. And otherwise, check me out with Dan Wismar and you when we come back here live Monday, same bat time, same bat channel. Noon, Daddy, across the Sports Fix Radio Network. Until then, have a great weekend. Happy Father's Day if you fit in the category. And then we'll see you Monday, baby, right here back on the Fix. Pretty.
So much hate up in this itty bitty city. If you can make it here, you can make it anywhere. Put your hands up in the air, everybody say yeah.